So I'm going to focus a little bit more on clinical trials. We talked about that a little bit this morning, but I think it's worth maybe going over again, and then we'll use some specific examples of some drugs that have been developed and are under development to illustrate exactly what Sonia's talking about. So again, what is a clinical trial? And we spoke about this. This is really to understand how a new drug works. Is it safe? Does it work in a particular disease? Also looking at existing drugs, and I'll give an example of that where we have an existing drug that works in other diseases, which actually has very good activity in non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And then once we've established that the drug works, then we need to compare it back and see, is it better than what we already have? Is it less toxic? And really, that's how we move the field forward. And then finally, to get that drug approved by the FDA. So I wanted to spend a moment. We spent some time talking about history in various contexts this morning, and I think it's helpful to see how things have evolved because we learn a lot. And this is Avicenna, a Persian physician and philosopher back in 1025, who first described the rules for clinical trials. And he said that a drug must be used on a simple, not a composite disease. And that way you can really understand if the drug is treating the disease. It's not a complicated situation where there are many different factors at play. The quality of the drug must correspond with the strength of the disease. Therefore, you're not going to use a really potent drug for the common cold. They really have to match up. And then he also said you have to test a drug on two different diseases to know whether the drug is really effective in the particular disease and it's not just effective in everything or a placebo effect. He also said you must see a time action. So you have to give the drug and then see a positive effect to know that it's really a causal relationship and that clinical trials must be performed on humans because, as we know, there are a lot of examples of drugs working in cell lines or in animal models, and then when you put them in humans, they don't actually pan out to what we would have hoped. And this was said back in 1025, so this man was really ahead of his time. So this is a very key example of a clinical trial in 1747, looking at sailors with scurvy, and this really, I think, illustrates how a clinical trial is done. So sailors were given various acidic substances, including vinegar, citrus fruits, and apple cider, and to see what happened. And the sailors who got the citrus fruits actually got better, and this was a description of scurvy. And this is how we figured out, not we, this is how it was figured out that vitamin C was important in this setting, and it was really done as a clinical trial without consent in an IRB, however. Things have gotten much more complicated since then. So what types of clinical trials are there? There are a number of different types of clinical trials I just wanted to highlight. There are preventative studies. And for lymphoma, we really don't have a lot in the way of preventative studies. Screening, so this is there any evidence that picking up and looking in asymptomatic patients who are feeling well, that if we pick up something early, it's going to change outcome? And this is really not the case for lymphoma either. This is really breast cancer, prostate cancer. Diagnostic tests, so can we study a new way of making a diagnosis and make sure that that is an effective modality? Quality of life, which is obviously critically important for any study that we're doing, we have to make sure that our intervention is actually making people feel better as well as treating the disease. And compassionate use, this is a specific situation where a drug exists for a rare population and is not FDA approved, but the FDA under certain circumstances will provide a drug. But really what we want to focus on is treatment studies. So when we have a new drug, as Sonia alluded to, the first thing that you want to do is to a proof of principle and to show that the drug really works in the test tube first in a simple model with cell lines or tumor cells. And then you take it to the next step and you do animal studies. And if you can kill tumor cells in animal models, then that gives us some hope that maybe there will be some good activity in people. In addition, animal studies are done to look for toxicities of drugs, and it's very important to understand that before we take drugs to human beings. And showed this morning, but just to recap, there are four phases of clinical trials. The first phase is the safety and evaluation of dose and schedule. This is done in a limited number of patients, understanding what is the right dose, what are the side effects, what safe dose can we take on to phase two, where we treat a group of patients with a similar condition and see really does this drug work and learn more about side effect profiles. Phase 3 confirms the activity either in typically in a randomized fashion, which we'll talk about in a moment, but some Phase 3 studies are not randomized, but lead to, ultimately, FDA approval of a drug. Phase 4 is where the drug is approved and we continue to collect information to make sure that we understand as much as we can about the toxicity profile. So here's an example of Phase 1 studies. These in non-cancer populations are often done in healthy volunteers, so you'll read about this. You know, people can get paid to be in a Phase 1 study to test a new drug, but in cancer patients that's not true. And we, in most Phase 1 studies, a drug is initially given to patients with many different types of cancers to evaluate that dose and schedule and to see the toxicity profile. There are some examples, however, as we're developing more targeted drugs where it doesn't necessarily make sense to study a new drug, even in Phase 1 in multiple different cancers. So you'll see many more examples of Phase 1 studies being done in hematologic or blood cancers. Again, we establish the safe dose and schedule and evaluate the side effects. And we look for a preliminary signal is, does this drug work in this particular patient population? So here is an example of a Phase 1 clinical trial, and this is the Phase 1 study of rituximab that was done in the 90s. So you start with a dose, and this is a typical what we call 3x3 design. So you take three patients and you treat them at a particular dose, here a low dose, 10 milligrams per meter squared, and if there, you evaluate those patients, see what the toxicity is, and if it's tolerated, then you escalate the dose of the drug. And you continue on with three patients and evaluate all the side effects. So the side effects for rituximab when it was first given, and now as we know, fevers are common. Rarely patients will have gastrointestinal side effects like nausea, but not very typical. Chills, low blood pressure, very rare. Wheezing on occasion, and low platelets. So actually, in the Phase 1 study, it was determined that this drug was actually very safe. And the best part was that more than half of patients in the Phase 1 study had significant shrinkage of their lymphoma. This was very exciting. This is the monoclonal antibody. This is a targeted therapy. So then what do? Then you want to test it in the Phase 2 setting. So you want to get a lot of different types of patients. You want to have some heterogeneity to your population, and that's depicted here by all these different people. And then you're going to study this drug in patients with non-Hodgkin lymphoma and, again, see what is the true rate of response, how well does it work, and what are the side effects. When we give it to more patients, are we going to see anything that we didn't see in the Phase 1 study? So this is an example of a Phase 2 study for rituximab therapy in patients who have slow-growing or indolent lymphomas who've been previously treated. So in this study, as you can see, it's a bigger study. It has 166 patients, which is actually a fairly large size for a Phase 2 study. And the drug, and you'll notice when drugs are in clinical trials, they have letters and numbers. So this is IDEX C2B8, and this is rituximab as we know it now. And it was given at the dose of 375 milligrams per meter squared, given weekly for four doses. And there's a story behind how this was chosen, and it really wasn't necessarily based on this was the best choice, but this is what they had available, and it was tolerable. So this is the dose that has moved forward. And again, it was well tolerated with fevers and infusional type reactions, which is what we typically see with rituximab, were the most common events, but very manageable, very few serious side effects. And again, almost half of the patients responded to the drug, and this is people who've had prior treatment. So again, this was very, very exciting. And it led to the FDA approving the drug in this indication, meaning in patients with previously treated indolent lymphoma. The drug was approved in 1997. So what about Phase 3 studies? What's the goal of a Phase 3 study? And I think in patients who don't have cancer, in many, you know, cardiology and other diseases, Phase 3 studies are often placebo randomized controlled studies. And I think a lot of patients with cancer here, Phase 3 study, oh, that's not for me. I don't want a placebo. Well, we couldn't do that. That wouldn't be ethical in cancer medicine to give a patient a placebo. So really, when we do randomized studies, the goal is to take a large population of patients who have similar characteristics and then randomly assign them to one treatment arm or the other so that we can really compare what's better. But obviously, we're going to give the patients in the control group the standard of care, so the best treatment that we know, and then the experimental group is going to be what we think is going to be even better. And that's how cancer and lymphoma studies are done. In some very rare circumstances, we might do a placebo trial if, for instance, we're talking about a maintenance study where it is not standard of care to give anything after the initial treatment, then we might randomize patients to maintenance rituximab versus observation because it would be considered ethical. But in most situations, we don't do that. So here's an example, which I spoke about a little bit earlier, of a phase 3 study, and this was actually done in France, in patients with diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. Patients who were 60 to 80 years old were actually randomized, 399 patients. We work with statisticians, and the statisticians will tell us, okay, this is how many people you need to put on this study in order to determine whether there's really a difference between these two arms. It's not that we just pull a number out of the air. It's we really work very hard to figure out exactly how many patients do we need to treat in order to answer a question. So 399 patients, half got R-CHOP, half got CHOP. It was a pretty straightforward study, and not surprisingly to those of us who are watching this story unfold, R-CHOP was better, well tolerated, and became the standard treatment. So this was a big advance, and this was in 2002, and this remains for most patients with diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, putting MYC and other things aside that we talked about this morning, the standard of care. So what about phase 4? What is phase 4? What's an example here? You know, there are lots of drugs out on the market, and the pharmaceutical companies are required to collect more information after lots of patients have been treated. And occasionally, a very important long-term toxicity will be identified, and then we let the public know about that so that we can be on the lookout for that. So again, we talked in the morning about oversight, and obviously this is extremely important. These studies are done very carefully and cautiously, and the studies can be done by a number of different groups, either pharmaceutical companies in collaboration with physicians at different sites. Those are called investigator-initiated studies. So if I have a disease that I'm very interested in and I want to study it, I can write a protocol and enroll patients. That's an investigator-initiated study. Or in lymphoma, if we're talking about a rare disease, say we have Waldenstrom's and we want to study a particular treatment in Waldenstrom's, I can't do that alone because we don't have enough patients. So we get together a cooperative group or a number of different centers and everybody agrees on how we're going to proceed, and then we have a multi-center study. Again, we have lots of oversight from the institutional review boards to make sure that we're ethically conducting our study and that from the very beginning, if new side effects are identified during the course of the treatment, then we will go back to the patients, inform them, and have them sign a consent form all over again. And that way, we really keep everyone well informed of what we know in real time. So just a few FDA definitions, because you'll hear about this as you hear and read about the drug approval process. So a standard review, once a company has filed a new drug, it takes 10 months for the FDA to turn around and give a response as to whether they're going to approve a drug or not. 10 months is a pretty long time, so the FDA has responded to a lot of pressure from lots of different organizations and patients and physicians and said, okay, if in cancer medicine often we really want a priority review and get it reviewed more quickly, which is defined as a 6-month turnaround time. And then there's what's known as an accelerated approval. So for a full approval, typically the FDA wants to see an endpoint of do more patients live if they get a particular treatment compared to the standard of care. It takes a long time, particularly in these diseases where we're hopefully curing a lot of patients or patients are going to live for a long time with a particular disease. Therefore, the FDA will allow what we call surrogate endpoints. So how many patients' disease started to grow, and that's called progression-free survival, and that can be an endpoint. Sometimes there are other what we call biomarkers, other indicators of how is this drug working that the FDA will accept as accelerated approval. And this is really an area that is under a lot of negotiation and trying to get the FDA to work with all of us to approve drugs more quickly, but also in a safe way, because we want to make sure that we're not causing unexpected harm by pushing things through too quickly. So fast track designation is when a company will assign a drug to a fast track, go to the FDA, and the FDA works very carefully and closely with the pharmaceutical company about the drug development, and they will help them figure out what studies should be done, what the FDA is looking for. And if the FDA accepts a drug as a fast track application, then it's eligible for accelerated priority review. It's also under rolling review, which means the company can submit data in real time instead of waiting till all the data is together and then putting a package. The other thing I didn't mention with accelerated approval is when you get accelerated approval for a drug, the drug companies then have to come back and do more studies to really prove that it has held up, so that the FDA can withdraw an accelerated approval if, with longer follow-up, the drug doesn't pan out. So that's a protection. And then breakthrough therapy sort of takes fast track even one step further, and the FDA becomes involved in the drug approval process very early as phase one, and the drug company and the FDA make a commitment to develop these drugs together. So in a nutshell, how do we do clinical trials? Well, first you write the protocol, which can take a lot of work. There's a lot of back and forth and making sure everything is very clearly explained. Once the protocol has been approved, then you find investigators at different medical centers or clinics to work with you and to enroll patients. Then it goes to the IRB, and the IRBs often make changes or suggestions about how the protocol looks. Once the protocol is open, then we recruit patients and treat patients. Over time, we get our data back, and we see how are things going, and then we take all that data, and then it's analyzed by our statisticians very carefully. Then it is presented in public fora, and initially it's often presented at meetings like the American Society of Hematology or the American Society of Clinical Oncology, and that's where you hear about what's new and exciting. Then once we have all that data together, then the drug is filed to the FDA, and the FDA makes a decision, and hopefully they approve the drug. So now to go to a few specific examples, and we've already talked a bit about brentuximab, but let's focus on this for a moment again. This is an image of Hodgkin lymphoma, and I just think this Reed-Sternberg cell is the most interesting looking cell. It's this owl's eye cell in the middle of the diagram here, and it is the cancer cell in Hodgkin's. It is the minority of cells. It's 1% or less of all of the cells you see when you biopsy a lymph node that's involved by Hodgkin's. And are surrounding the Reed-Sternberg cells are lots of other normal cells like lymphocytes and plasma cells and neutrophils, other immune cells that are actually normal. It's the Reed-Sternberg cell that secretes hormones that draw these cells in. So as has been discussed before, there's a protein called CD30 that lives on the surface of that Reed-Sternberg cell. And this is just a depiction of how that Reed-Sternberg cell attracts all these other normal cells in and around it. So SGN30 was the first attempt at targeting CD30 in Hodgkin lymphoma. And this is a image of depiction of a cancer cell, and bound to it you can see the antibody bound on the surface to CD30. And they did a phase two study. Everyone thought, well, with the success of rituximab, this is going to be a home run. We're going to do an anti-CD30 antibody in Hodgkin lymphoma and what's known as anaplastic large cell lymphoma, which is a T-cell lymphoma, which is rare but has CD30 on the surface. And what happened? They gave the drug, and everybody was quite disappointed in that the drug really didn't work at all in Hodgkin's, and there were a few responses, though very minimal shrinkage in patients with this specific type of T-cell lymphoma. It was well tolerated, but I think we were all very disappointed when we saw the results of this trial. But the company didn't give up and said, well, you know, let's take another approach. Let's not throw this away. We now have developed these CD30 antibodies. What if we attach them to a chemotherapy drug and use the Trojan horse approach and deliver that drug into the center of the cell? And as you've seen multiple times this morning, this is an antibody called an antibody-drug conjugate. It binds on the surface of the Reed-Sternberg cell, and in Hodgkin lymphoma, that the drug and the antibody are taken into the cell, and the drug is released and poisons the cell's cytoskeleton so that the cell dies. So how was the drug taken to the FDA? What was the approval process for brentuximab? So in Hodgkin lymphoma, when we have a new drug, first place that you want to study it is in patients who have had previous initial standard therapy and in whom, unfortunately, the disease has come back. And there was a study, a phase two study, all the patients got this drug after stem cell transplant. And then there was a similar study done in anaplastic large cell lymphoma, a phase 2 study in patients who had been previously treated and in whom the drug had come back, the disease had come back. And what was found was actually this was an extremely active drug. The majority of patients in both diseases responded. The side effect profile was manageable. The predominant side effect is peripheral neuropathy because that MMAE drug poisons the cytoskeleton and is similar to vinblastine and vincristine, which cause peripheral neuropathy. But overall, it was a tolerable drug with a very high response rate, so the FDA approved the drug. So now what? We have this drug. It's on the market. We can administer it to patients who have recurrent Hodgkin lymphoma or anaplastic large cell lymphoma. So what do we do next? So now that we know it works, now the question is how do we incorporate it into the initial therapy and even improve? We have very good outcomes in Hodgkin's in general, but how do we make those even better? Can we use this drug to cure even more patients with the initial treatment? So there is an ongoing phase 3 study, and this is in patients with Hodgkin lymphoma who have never been treated previously, who have stage 3 or 4 disease, and the patients are randomly assigned to brentuximab plus adriamycin, vinblastine, and dacarbazine. We know that bleomycin, when given together, and this was discovered in a phase 1 study when the two drugs were given together, with brentuximab and ABVD, that there was lung toxicity. So the decision was made to take the bleomycin out, and the bleomycin is probably the least effective drug in this combination and causes a lot of lung toxicity even on its own. So this is being compared to standard chemotherapy with ABVD. This is an international study and is ongoing. And in a few years, we hope that we will have an answer. This needs to be a very, very large study because if you want to see a small difference between two different arms, you have to put lots of patients on the study, and that's why it's an international study. But we hope in the future, in patients with stage 3 or 4 disease, we're going to have better treatments and cure even more people up front. In non-Hodgkin lymphoma, in this T-cell lymphoma, there are a number of different studies, and it's been realized that there are other T-cell lymphomas in addition to anaplastic large cell lymphoma, which have the protein CD30 on the surface. There are also some B-cell lymphomas that have CD30 on the surface, so a phase 2 study is ongoing giving the drug to these patients to see which subsets of patients may benefit, and there have been some interesting early results. And then there is a phase 3 study in patients who have CD30 positive T-cell lymphoma. And patients get brentuximab plus cytoxin, adriamycin, and prednisone. This is CHOP minus the vincristine. The reason that was done is we know that the brentuximab causes peripheral neuropathy, so we want to minimize that. And it's being compared to standard dose. This should say CHOP. This is in T-cell lymphoma, so not R-CHOP. It should say CHOP. So hopefully, again, in a few years, we hope to have the answer in this subset of patients. What's better, brentuximab plus CHP or CHOP? So now switching gears, going to talk about a different type of drug. And, you know, as Sony alluded to, we learn a lot from the past and prior experience in giving drugs. And this is an advertisement that was in the British Medical Journal, and you probably can't see it, it says 1959, and this is an advertisement for thalidomide, which was being marketed as a safe sedating drug for patients. And you can see in the bottom it says, particularly suitable for children and the aged. Well, we know this really wasn't the case, and this has led to experiences like this are why the FDA is so cautious, because we can't let these types of things happen. This is thalidomide we're talking about, and it has had a checkered past. So it was introduced in the late 50s as a sedative, and it was marketed to pregnant women to help with morning sickness and to help with insomnia. Well, it was a disaster, as you all know, and there was a very tragic toxicity of babies being born with major limb abnormalities. So eventually, the drug was pulled from the market, and it was really a very low moment in drug development. Then in the 1990s, based on some scientific work, there was someone hypothesized that perhaps it would have activity in leprosy and HIV, and that was actually the case. And then it was later found to be a very active drug in multiple myeloma, which is related to lymphoma. It's the most mature form of a B cell is a plasma cell, and that's the cell that gives rise to multiple myeloma. So based on that and knowing that it's very active in myeloma, it was then taken forward in some subsets of lymphoma. Now, thalidomide has a fairly significant side effect profile. It causes peripheral neuropathy again, which is a very bothersome side effect for patients, numbness and tingling in the fingers and toes. And it also causes fatigue. So that led to what we call the second generation of this class of drugs, which are known as immunomodulatory drugs. And they have lots of different effects on tumor cells. And this just sort of depicts many of the different pathways and mechanisms by which lenalidomide affects tumor cells and the environment, as Sony described, the environment in which tumor cells live. And the immune system is also affected by lenalidomide. So this attacks tumor cells in multiple different ways. So in 2005, this drug was approved for a hematologic disorder called myelodysplastic syndrome, a subset of patients, and it's a very active drug in that setting. It was then approved in 2006 for multiple myeloma, and then quite recently it was approved for use in mantle cell lymphoma, where it has a very significant response rate in patients who've had other prior therapies. So the drug is now being developed and studied in a number of different types of lymphoma. It is active in a subset of patients with aggressive lymphoma or diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. It's active in many different types of indolent lymphoma, including follicular lymphoma, marginal zone lymphoma. It's also active in chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and it's active, as I just said, in mantle cell lymphoma. So there are a lot of ongoing studies trying to figure out where is the best place to incorporate this drug. Should we put it in combination with chemotherapy drugs, or should we use it in patients who are in remission to try to lengthen remissions after stem cell transplant? There are a number of different places this drug is under current investigation. So in follicular lymphoma, which is the prototype disease of indolent lymphomas, how have these discoveries sort of led to change in the way that we treat patients? And there's an evolution over time. You know, maybe 20 years ago, patients would get CHOP or CVP, which is Cytoxan, Vincristine, and Prednisone, CHOP minus the Adriamycin, and that's conventional chemotherapy. Along came Rituxan, and then Rituxan plus CHOP, or Rituxan plus CVP, really became the standard of care. Then a few years ago, a drug called Bendamustine, which was approved in Europe and used in Europe, in East Germany in particular, for over 30 years, finally came to the U.S. This is a drug which has a very favorable side effect profile, probably more favorable compared to CHOP because there are no steroids and it doesn't cause peripheral neuropathy. It does cause drops in blood counts. So there was a study in Europe comparing R-CHOP to Bendamustine plus Rituxan, and Bendamustine plus Rituxan was better in most subtypes of slow-growing lymphoma, and it had a better side effect profile. So that's a very commonly used combination in indolent lymphoma. There's also been a study looking at, well, what if we take and combine lenalidomide with rituximab in patients who've never been treated with follicular lymphoma? And this has been presented and looks very, very promising. Patients tolerate this quite well, and it's extremely active. So then the next question is, how can we make that even better? And there are some ongoing studies combining Rituxan plus lenalidomide plus new drugs, plus a drug called ibrutinib. There's an ongoing study through the Alliance or the CLGB in previously untreated follicular lymphoma. So this is a question, and this is where we hope to move. We're going from combination chemotherapy that kills dividing cells to much more smart and targeted combinations. So I presented this slide earlier this morning as well, and this is one of the pathways that we know goes awry in B-cell lymphomas involving the B-cell receptor, and there are a number of different parts of this pathway that have been, quote, targeted with new drugs. And the first one we're going to talk about is ibrutinib, which targets BTK, or Bruton's tyrosine kinase. And when this pathway is active, it leads to cells dividing and living when they shouldn't. And if you can block this BTK with ibrutinib, we see some pretty remarkable results. So ibrutinib has been studied in a number of different indolent lymphomas and mantle cell lymphoma, and it is a very active drug. It is an oral drug. It has quite a favorable side effect profile thus far in the patients who've received it, and some patients have been on it for very long periods of time and continue on this drug. And again, it's very active in both of these diseases, and it will be going to the FDA in early 2014, and a lot of us are very excited about this. And once we have the drug, there are a lot of ongoing studies combining this with Rituxan, combining it with bendamustine and Rituxan. There's a whole series of new studies. And if you look this drug up on clinicaltrials.gov, you'll find that there's something like 20 ongoing studies with this drug. So this is very exciting. What about other pathways within the B-cell receptor signaling cascade? And we mentioned this morning GS1101, which blocks PI3 kinase. There are many drugs that block this pathway, and the drug idelalisib is the one that's sort of furthest along. I think the hardest thing about this is learning how to pronounce this drug. It took me about 3 months to really get it rolling off my tongue. And you still, if you think about it too much, it won't come out. And now I finally got it, and it actually sounds quite good. But it's a tough name. But idelalisib is is another very interesting drug that's targeted in the B-cell receptor pathway. It's been submitted to the FDA for patients with relapsed indolent lymphomas who've had prior Rituxan and are no longer responding to Rituxan. It, again, is an oral drug that has a very nice side effect profile, and there are lots of ongoing studies with this drug, including in CLL in combination with ofatumumab and other drugs. In mantle cell lymphoma in combination, and Sony has a study using this in the CLGB, and in indolent lymphoma. So how do we choose what drugs are going to be best for particular patients? And this is something that there's lots and lots of investigation going on currently. And this is the gene expression profiling that you've heard about, and we get a tumor biopsy and look at which genes are turned up and down in particular patients' tumor samples to get a better sense of, when you look under the microscope at a specimen of diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, you can't tell whether that's going to be one that's going to be a favorable actor and be cured with R-CHOP, or one that's going to be more difficult to treat. And this is really starting to give us clues into which ones we need to work harder on. So the ABC subtype, which is the type over here on the right-hand side again, as pointed out previously, is the subset that seems to be a little bit more difficult to treat. And there's evidence that both ibrutinib and lenalidomide may be good drugs for that subset of patients. So there are ongoing studies in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma to incorporate these drugs up front with R-CHOP to see can we cure more patients up front. And there is an ongoing study which may have finished, I don't know whether it's done, the ibrutinib in relapsed diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. In the ABC subtype, there seems to be a signal of activity, and not in the other subset, the germinal center B-cell subset. So this is just to show sort of where we've come, and hopefully things will continue to improve over time. But these are the approved drugs in non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And it was interesting to put this slide together. You can go onto the FDA website, and you can just type in approved drugs in non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And it was both sobering and exciting kind of at the same time to look at this timeline. And you can see there are a number of different standard chemotherapy drugs that have been approved in non-Hodgkin lymphoma that are quite active, and these are in the pink. And then over since 1990, there have been a number of drug approvals. Denileukin diffitox is a drug called ONTAC, which is used in T-cell lymphomas and is no longer manufactured because there are some other drugs that have come along and probably replaced it. Liposomal cytarabine is a drug that is used when lymphoma goes into the central nervous system, and it can be injected into the spinal fluid. And then rituximab, as we've talked about a lot. And then after 2000, here we have seven drugs that have been approved from 2000 to 2010, bendamustine, bortezomib, which is what's called a proteasome inhibitor, which has been approved in mantle cell lymphoma, ibrutumumab, which is a shortened name for the full name, which is Zevalin. This is radioimmunotherapy, and it's Rituxan that has a radioactive moiety attached to it. And both that and tocetumumab or Bexxar are approved drugs. Bexxar is no longer going to be manufactured, but Zevalin is still available. And then there are a number of drugs, particularly in cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, that were approved, and in peripheral T-cell lymphoma. Pralatrexate is sort of a relative to methotrexate, and that was recently approved. Romidepsin and vorinostat fall into a class of drugs called HDAC inhibitors, and they were also approved in cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. after 2010. So within the past couple of years, brentuximab, as we spoke about, was approved in T-cell lymphoma and anaplastic large cell lymphoma, which is CD30 positive, and lenalidomide was approved in mantle cell. CLL has six drugs that have been approved, and the drugs that were discovered before 1990, chlorambucil, cytoxin, and fludarabine, now these are very active drugs and remain part of our initial approach to CLL. We now combine them with Rituxan, and Rituxan doesn't actually have a label specifically for CLL, but it is active in CLL, so it is used in combination. And then after 2000, alemtuzumab, which is a monoclonal antibody to CD52, was approved. We have bendamustine, is also active in CLL. And ofatumumab, which is a novel anti-CD20 antibody that's related to Rituxan, but maybe a little bit more potent for CLL, has also been approved. But again, we're hoping that both ibrutinib and hopefully idelalisib will eventually be approved, as well as a lot of other new drugs in the future. And this is Hodgkin lymphoma, and there really wasn't much going on for new drugs in Hodgkin's. And part of that is because ABVD is such a good combination that a lot of patients don't really need additional therapy, so there wasn't as much of a focus on that. But now that we have brentuximab, things are looking really exciting in Hodgkin's, and I suspect there will be even more drugs that will come along in Hodgkin's. So I just hope that we've spent some time today convincing you that clinical trials really are the future, and they're done in a very careful way. They're done to protect patients and to really benefit all of patients to develop new therapies. And we've really come a very long way since mustard gas, thank goodness. So we're going to get rid of that. And now we're looking at really targeting pathways in the malignant cells to really make better drugs that have better side effect profiles. So how do you find a clinical trial? And there's been a lot of focus on that today, and there will be ongoing. You now know about the app. So communication, talk to your oncologist. It doesn't matter where you're getting treated. Your oncologist is going to be knowledgeable about how to find clinical trials if they're appropriate and refer you to other people if there aren't clinical trials ongoing at your particular center. As you know, the LRF has lots of resources from the helpline to the app. There's lots of people to talk to who can really help you at lymphoma.org and on the app. And then the internet. You know, I think the internet is a double-edged sword. There's a lot of information on the internet that may or may not be reliable, but there are certainly very good websites that have lots of information about finding clinical trials, including cancer.gov, clinicaltrials.gov, and cancertrials.org.